The assertion that Tesla's Autopilot features reduces airbag deployments by 40%, made by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration back in January, may use faulty data and cannot be replicated by researchers, a lawsuit filed on Wednesday claims. The National Highway Traffic Safety Administration opened an investigation into a May 2016 crash involving a Tesla Model S cruising in its semi-autonomous autopilot mode, resulting in the death of the passenger. The investigation found the crash rate for Tesla vehicles dropped nearly 40% after Autosteer was installed. At the time, this was deemed a big win for Tesla, as it basically implied the car's autonomous features are ultimately safe, and the fault was of the driver not paying attention. However, the Quality Control Systems Corporation, a Maryland-based research group, called NHTSA's claim surprising as the high reduction in crashes from Autosteer installation is extraordinary. R.A. Whitfield, director of the corporation, pointed to the claim that crash reductions are associated with the installation of Autosteer, rather than the actual use of Autosteer. He said, like with seat belts, the reduction in injuries is only seen with the use of the belt, not just if it's installed in the car. To get the benefit of Autosteer, you need to turn it on. So shouldn't have NHTSA studied that? Whitfield said in an interview. Furthermore, Quality Control Systems claims NHTSA's analysis doesn't meet scientific standards because it does not allow for an assessment of statistical confidence intervals or statistical significance, all indicators pointing to how precise a finding is. The complaint says NHTSA also did not give the data quality control systems originally requested from a Freedom of Information Act request in February. Whitfield said the corporation waited until April for NHTSA to provide the requested files, but the agency still did not provide them, prompting him to file a suit. If the safety benefits of Autosteer are as positive as the agency claims, why wouldn't they want independent scientists to have the data in order to replicate these extraordinary results? Quality Control Systems states on their website. Neither a representative from the U.S. Department of Transportation nor Tesla immediately responded to requests for comment from Jalopnik, but this story will be updated if they do.
Honda's Type R has always been very desirable, offering high performance with great design. Now Honda have added supreme comfort, making this a great car to drive anywhere, any place. A racing driver is one of the top jobs young people aspire to, apparently, along with becoming a footballer and a pop star. So no surprise there then. This crossed my mind as I hurtled down the straight at the Lausitzring near Dresden in East Germany. I dared look at the speedometer. Ahead of me was the instructor whose racing line I was following, and behind me a colleague with whom I would swap places in a couple of laps time. Now generally, I am not a fan of track driving and would rather spend a night watching darts than put myself through the ordeal of flinging a car around a lot of dangerous bends. However, this was no ordinary car. This was the latest version of Honda Civic Type R, which I had already driven down the Autobahn to the Euro Speedway, and I was intrigued as to how it would perform. I knew all about the amazing aerodynamics which kept it glued to the track, or sucked on, as one expert from Honda put it. And it was so much more comfortable than the last model. I would be happy to sink into these seats and take it around town, potholes and all. Partly this is because the genius Hideki Kakinuma, who created this car, has delivered three driving modes: comfort for everyday use, sport for a bit of performance when you are out and about, and plus R for the track. So there we were on the track putting the modes to the test, and for once I had every confidence this car would not let me down. It is the latest generation of the Civic Type R with the 2.0-liter VTEC turbocharged engine, which has been boosted by 10 to 320 picoseconds. Switch it on and just listen to the soundtrack. It comes in two specs: the standard spec, which gives you masses of features like forward collision warning, traffic sign recognition, lane keep assist, lane departure warning, and of course, sat nav. It looks amazing, it always has done, and the rear spoiler now sits above a triple exhaust system, which is both practical and elegant. The new air intakes and little air flicks create even better stability, and the big sporty looking one on the bonnet is practical too. David McDonald, the UK project leader, explained, "Honda engines tend to be quite hot, so we need to keep them cooled. At the rear we have vortex generators which force the air over the spoiler for more efficiency," and then he added conspiratorially, "at the factory we call them chocolate boxes." Certainly there is more than a little black magic to this new offering from Honda, which will be delivered globally from its factory in Swindon. Japan have already ordered 2,200, the USA, home of the muscle car, 16,000. Europe has ordered 3,700, of which 2,500 are for the UK. It's a bit like an election, really. The people have spoken and they want a Honda Civic Type R.
There is no doubt that many who buy the eagerly anticipated Honda Civic Type R when it arrives in Australia this October will want it for the performance. After all, with 228 kilowatts of power from its 2.0-liter turbocharged engine, what was once a sensible family hatch has been turned into something of a fire-breathing monster. Honda claims it'll hit 100 kilometers per hour from standstill in just 5.7 seconds, and after driving it for a day there's little reason for disbelief because it goes, and goes hard. Just as many will be attracted to the outrageous styling because you'd better believe it. Despite all the pictures and motor show appearances seen so far, nothing can prepare even the temporary custodian for the Type R in the flesh. It is simply festooned with everything that's dramatic. The deep chin spoiler is further extended by a lip that curves up at the extremities to direct air around the front wheels. The extended wheel arches are anything but subtle, and the double-decker rear wing is huge. Everywhere you look there are vents, scoops, winglets and mysterious bumps to direct airflow and manage cooling, and the result is a car that will never go unnoticed. Beautiful it isn't. Hysterically over the top it definitely is. For those who haven't been following the lead up, which includes a record-breaking lap for front drive cars around the full-scale Nürburgring racetrack in Germany, this hot Civic is Honda's comeback from the dark days of the GFC, after which its cars tended towards the meek and mundane. The company needed something extroverted and outrageous, and, while visually and on paper the Type R fits the bill, it also needs to go, stop and handle to prove it has bite as well as bark. The good news is, after sessions on the racetrack, Germany's high-speed autobahns and normal urban and country roads, the Type R generally comes up smelling of roses. Starting with performance, the direct injection turbo engine doesn't just have a mighty power output, but with 400 Nm of torque it also has plenty of pulling power from the middle of the rev range, at about 3000 RPMs. There is more than a hint of turbo lag in higher gears below that figure, but once on the move its accelerative ability, during overtaking maneuvers, for instance, is strong and elastic. It's a long way from the picky, highly strung non-turbo engine we saw in the last Civic Type R from two vehicle generations ago, but interestingly, as well as being torquey, this engine is also happy to rev hard and long to its 7,000 RPMs. Cut out the proviso is that Australia will get a slightly detuned version of the 235 kilowatts engine used in Europe due to our lack of readily available 98-octane fuel, but it seems unlikely anyone will notice the difference. Honda claims that 0 to 100 km per hour time will be identical. The Type R comes with a 6-speed manual gearbox and no automatic option. Honda says that's because changing gears yourself is the true enthusiast's choice, although it leaves those with an auto-only license out in the cold. Regardless, the shift itself is positive and quick, and the simple, spherical machined alloy gear knob a gem, and the auto rev function for downshifts works perfectly. Forget about the heel and toe technique to blip the throttle to match engine revs before engaging a lower gear, it all happens for you. The engine definitely has an exhaust note which is roary but not always entirely pleasant. Honda reckons it has tuned the three outlets to provide positive pressure within the rear muffler at speed. The central pipe actually starts to suck instead of blow, to attenuate the sound produced, but the reality is with constant throttle at around 3000 RPMs there is a drone that is tiresome instead of spine-tingling. That said, this Type R seems far easier to live with than the last version seen in Australia. For instance, three driving modes are available that are easily accessible via a toggle switch next to the gear stick and gradually ramps up suspension stiffness, steering precision and throttle sensitivity among other parameters. In comfort mode the car feels more relaxed and the ride is compliant despite the very low profile, 20-inch tires but also due in part to the independent multi-link suspension that replaces previous torsion beam setups. It's not a quiet car, the engine note is ever-present, and all those air add-ons produce plenty of wind noise as speed builds, but the torquey engine, easy shifting gearbox, not to mention surprising comfort from aggressively sporty-looking seats, add up to a car that's nice to drive quietly through the suburbs. Crank the selector through sport mode, which is actually the default setting on startup, through to R+ and the Type R is ready for the racetrack. Apart from the available performance, which is huge and able to launch the car in never-ending streams of acceleration even in the higher gears, the Type R is surprisingly benign on the track. The steering is well-weighted and direct and the handling tends towards gentle understeer. 63% of the weight is over the front wheels, but the main thing is there are no surprises or twitchiness apart, perhaps, from some squirming under the kind of braking you'd hope to never see on public roads. Like the standard Civic it is based on, the wheelbase is longer than before at 2600mm so there's stability to go with the stiffness, the rear end seems particularly well glued to the road and overall, as a track day car, it's likely to inspire confidence to go quickly. The elephant in the Type R's room is that unlike some rivals, it's channeling lots of power through its front wheels and not all four. First impressions are it copes quite well in that torque steer, the effect of the driven wheel's torque output feeding back through the steering, is well controlled to non-existent but the final word on that should wait until it's driven on familiar, possibly damp, Australian urban roads. Overall then, in the Type R you have a car with plenty of raw appeal and not a small amount of ability when it comes to straight line speed, cornering prowess and even comfort, but still possesses enough raw edges to let the driver know it deserves the red H badge that adorns the bonnet. The styling, Honda insists, is purely functional in terms of aerodynamics, even if the result is something from a B-grade Hollywood street racing movie. Those who want spit and polish are already buying the faster VW Golf variants in droves. In the Civic Type R, others will find something completely different.